And I'd like to introduce myself. Some of you I know me, but some of you are new faces to me, so I'll just assume you don't. I'm Martin Sanchez Jankowski, and I have two sort of positions here. One is the director of the overall institute for the study of societal issues, and the other as director of this center called the Center for Ethnographic Research. And I want to welcome all of you to our talk today. And I would like to encourage you to take your cell phones out if you have them and make sure that they are on silent mode, because we're quite a small group. Even if we were a large group, we're in a small room, and that would in fact interrupt our speaker, and we wouldn't like that to happen. Before I begin, I'd like to make an announcement of the next event. On October the 14th, Professor Ann Swidler of the Sociology Department here at UC Berkeley will give a talk entitled Motel Ethnography Revisited. And that talk is from 4 to 5:30 here in the Vladovsky Room. Now, it's part of a series that we initiated at the Center for Ethnographic Research, which is called Views from the Field. And in it, it's ethnographers who have been doing field work combine both what they question was when they went to the field in terms of researching, and then a series of pictures of their sites, so you have a sense of what kind of environment they were carrying out their research in. It's always interesting, and pictures are always nice, and it gives you a sense of the kind of, cases that are being done and the environment in which those case studies are done. So I highly encourage you to come. They've been successful in the past, and there's a good discussion afterwards in both the substantive and the visual presentations go nicely together and also encourage discussion. Now, as you know, we have a typical format, which is that our speakers generally talk for around 45 minutes or so, and or less sometimes, depending on them. And at about around 5 o'clock, they quit, and it was open to us to start talking, asking questions, and getting into some kind of dialogue. At that point, I will come back up here and field questions. That is, you raise your hand, and I just kind of write down where you are, essentially, is what I do, because I don't know your names, and then I call on you in order of the queue, and she today will answer the questions. This relieves her of the responsibilities of having to decide who should get the next question, etc. So it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, and our speaker is Dr. Jacqueline Adams. And Dr. Adams is a part of our community here at ISSI, and we're happy to have her. She is an author of two books, quite impressively. One of the books is called Surviving Dictatorship, a work of visual sociology, and that's published by Routledge Press in the year 2012. And it examines the shantytown experiences of state violence, impoverishment, and activism under dictatorship. And the second monograph or book that she has published is Art Against Dictatorship. That's published by the University of Texas Press, and that came out in 2013 and analyzes a transnational human rights movement centered around the sale of dissident art. Today, she is going to talk to us about using visual methods to learn about human rights violations under dictatorship. And I would like you to welcome Dr. Adams.
So I'd like to say thank you very much to Issy and for inviting me to give this talk, and to Christine, Deborah, and Yuri for organizing it and putting together various parts of the publicity. And thank you all for your interest and for coming here today. So my goal in this talk is to describe the visual methods that I used really as an adjunct to semi-structured interviews and participant observation, but I used several different visual methods, and to reflect on some of the shortcomings basically what they tell us, what they can help us with, and some of the shortcomings. And this is work I'm going to be discussing based on three projects, one of which was where the research question was, what were the experiences that women in shantytowns had of state violence and exacerbated poverty under dictatorship in Chile? That was one project. And another project that preceded this, which these methods were used for, and they're linked, was how was art made in shantytowns and by relatives of the disappeared as well, to protest against the regime and to communicate what was happening to the outside world, and how was it exported, sold, and received. And those are really the two main projects I'll focus on. So without further ado, I'm going to start by going chronologically through the methods that I use, because I think that will make more sense. So I mentioned that we're looking at human rights violations in the recent past, because the military regime occurred in 73 and ended in 1990. So there are some challenges associated with finding out what happened, what the experiences were of women in shantytowns in the recent past, as you can imagine. I just want to show you an image to give you an idea of the places that we're looking at, the focus, the setting of the research, were shantytowns around the capital city, Santiago, and this is one where is a poorer one and a more recent one at that time. We know that because the houses are of wood, they tended to later on be of brick or more uniform, unless they've been government built, government planned. And this will come up in the talk. This is a house with a sloping roof and horizontal boards called a mediagua. It'll come up a bit later on, but just to give you a visual image to begin with. Now, the first method that I used, the first visual method that I used, was photographing art by dissident groups or survivors and building up a database of these artworks, which I then used to answer particular research questions. And this is the artwork in question. It's called an arpillera. These are pictures in cloth made by women living in shantytowns, and they typically show unemployment as a theme, which is what this one does. You can see a factory here with its jagged roof, an office, and this is a sign saying only 3 vacancies and people outside looking for work. So they typically show unemployment, the results of unemployment, exacerbated poverty, inability to afford food, education, decent housing, and decent healthcare. And they showed women's collective efforts to solve these problems and their efforts to undermine the regime. That's what this body of work did. So how did I get hold of these works, and what did I do with them? Well, I was at the very beginning of the first project, and I was interviewing Chilean exiles who had stayed on after the regime. This is 5 years after when I first began this very first project in England, and also Chilean exiles in Switzerland, and human rights activists in both those countries, nationals from those countries, who'd sold these artworks and sent the funding back to people suffering under the regime in Chile and back to these women. And they'd kept some. So I would conduct a semi-structured interview about their involvement in how they received them, how they sold them, how they got involved. And then I would ask to photograph their collection, whereupon I started to build up this collection, this visual data set, which I continued to build up later briefly in the United States, where a couple of academics I met had collections, and in Chile, where I had return exiles, returnee refugees who had collections, and members of the main exporting organization, which was called the Vicaría de la Solidaridad, Vicariate of Solidarity. It was a human rights organization protected by the Catholic Church that exported most of these, and tens of thousands of these were made over the course of the regime. Eventually, my data set numbered about 500. So a data set, and I'll show you some more in a minute, but a data set of artworks enduring artworks by individuals enduring state violence and exacerbated poverty can give us information about, now bearing in mind these are mediated works, right, by the authors, the artist's viewpoint, and the intermediary, but nevertheless, they do give us insights into the artist's experiences of state violence, poverty, hunger, etc., coping strategies, what they did collectively to deal with these issues, activism, and fear, in the case of this data set. We know about the fear from the self-censorship, which I'll point out shortly. They also give us insights into the artist's concerns, not only their own concerns, but concerns about other groups, their understandings of the situation, the causes of their problems, and the extent of awareness that they might or might not have about human rights and themselves as enduring violations. Now, of course, this is complicated by the fact that often when you do get artworks made under dictatorship, they might be exported via an intermediary, and certainly in this case, the Vicaria did impose, this human rights organization in Santiago, did impose on these women certain rules, literally rules. And one of them, fortunately for me, was that they had to depict their own lived experience. They didn't always do this, but that was a rule. And there were rules about the content, the format, the style, etc. And the Vicaria did this because it wanted to sell to help these women. So it was aware of its understanding of buyer demand, what buyers wanted, and it would, especially towards the end of the regime, tell the women to depict things that it thought buyers wanted. So bearing this in mind, these images do nevertheless shed light on the women's experiences, and we can discuss why. So here, for example, is an experience of the detention of the father of the man of the house and a woman and her six children who live in Emilia, very likely, the sloping roof, the horizontal boards, they're all thinking of him. So that expresses the difficulty of being alone with a husband who's in detention. This one tells really three stories. The top one says that there is no, indicates by a symbol that recurs in several of these pictures, that there's no running water to houses. You can see the taps with the X. And the bottom one, so people had to line up at public taps in the shantytowns. And the bottom one shows a coping strategy. As they didn't have enough money to feed their families adequately, many women in shantytowns relied on donations and begging in markets, and they were able to collectively feed their children. But this also indicates an awareness of human rights, right themselves as having rights that are being violated, because this says in Spanish, all children have the right to food security. And this is because the Vicaría de la Solidaridad early on gave the women copies of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and asked them to draw inspiration from them to create Ad Villeras. This is in the very early years, which they did. This is an artwork depicting unemployment. This is an octopus saying unemployment, and it affects all people in all walks of life. So these words are different. Baker, shoemaker, journalist, they're all different professions. And here we have the theme of malnutrition entrapping everyone in its web, so to speak. And here we have one indicating, I mentioned the Adbiaristas, concerns, the artist's concerns. So this indicates that they were concerned about internal exile, relegación, where people were detained and sent to an area with a very hostile climate or difficult conditions and kept there as in internally exiled. Now we don't know if this was the experience of the person who made it, that her relative, her husband, for example, had been there, or if they were, as they often were, sympathetic towards other groups, such as artists, fishermen, and others, and that this is what they're depicting. This one again suggests an awareness of rights. It shows some people live in tents because, for example, new land seizures, when they seized land, the first abode was often the tent. And this is typically indicating a middle-class neighborhood or dwelling in the lexicon of the Adbiaras. It's a three-story building, which you don't see very much in shantytowns. And this says everyone has the right to decent housing. Again, from 79, about that period when they were using the Universal Declaration for inspiration. So what are some of the issues we have? Well, first of all, briefly about analysis. I use this data set to ask two really specific questions, both the basis of articles. One was, how have the artworks changed over time? And I knew about the dates, roughly, not of every particular one, but I could recognize styles. And they revealed, together with interviews that I'd conducted, that the art went from highly denunciatory to more innocuous, showing scenes of even countryside life and far less violence in the later period than earlier. So I use them to address a particular research question too, in addition always to field notes and semi-structured interview transcripts. So there are some issues with the analysis of these works. Very often, they don't tell you, as you've just seen, the name of the person who made them. We don't know where they live. We often don't know when exactly they were made. We don't always understand the meaning of the image. We don't always understand whether it's the artist's lived experience or another group's or the intermediary's instructions. And then another issue is that one may have only a tiny sample of the total number produced, as is the case, unfortunately. And we can resolve some of these problems, and this is a theme throughout the talk, where I believe that many visual databases can best be used most fruitfully in most rigorous research by triangulation with both other forms of visual data and textual data, which I'll show you shortly, and also field notes or interview transcripts. So comparing various pieces of information from these sources, one can better understand and know more about the images in question. Now, we may think it's fairly uncommon for art to be produced like this under dictatorship. It is, but it is done in a lot of situations of state violence. So, for example, Laotian immigrants in the United States, as you may know, produce large tapestries in cloth where they describe their having to leave Laos because of the violence there and they're staying in refugee camps and the journey to the United States. In Mexico, southern Mexico, in Chiapas, the Zapatista movement, you had women in Zapatista villages making small dolls of Zapatista militants with bandanas and guns, and these were exported as well. And in 2007 in Union Square in the city, I saw works by women from the Palestinian Authority, and they were selling embroideries by women with very low incomes in Palestine, foreign income. So, as a phenomenon, it's not that uncommon. But yes, it's not that common either. We see here an example of. I'm going to show you this to explain about how textual data can help us analyze and understand visual data. So, here is an ephemera showing four men in dark suits and a woman, a basket, and children. It's difficult to understand what this means, but fortunately, at the back, as sometimes happened, there was a little pocket mm-hmm. with a piece of paper explaining. And this tells us quite a lot about the artist as well. It says, this woman is freedom, and she's been beaten up by these four men who want to take away her basket with bread, which she has for her children, the Chileans. So here we can also see what we already know. This woman hasn't had the opportunity of much education, certain spelling issues here, but it's very helpful for us to understand what it's about. But this also tells us about fear and self-censorship, because she's not saying, this is the junta, as I learned in an interview with the owner of this artwork, the person who collected it. So interview data suggested, the owner of this collection where this was, said, these are the junta, so these are the four leaders of the military regime. And this is obviously a symbolic image where they are crushing Chilean residents, Chilean inhabitants. So this brings us into the next form of visual data gathering I did, which I call art elicitation. It's a term I invented, and I base it on photo elicitation. But instead of using photos, it involves asking people about artworks when the artwork's directly in front of them. And I used it myself mainly to learn about how the artworks were made by showing women artworks from other neighborhoods. So I was a participant observing in shantytowns, groups making the artwork, and I brought in artworks from other neighborhoods. And by their reactions to it, I was able to get a sense of how they do things differently. So they talked about, oh, we don't do it this way, we use different materials, etc. And I also used this with when I was interviewing, when I was photographing collections of ephemeras, and I was asking the owner of the collection to tell me about the collection that she had. So art elicitation can tell us a lot of the missing information, not always, but sometimes a lot. Can tell us about the message of the artwork, the author, the date, what the artists were experiencing, constraints on the artist's ability to say what they wanted to say, stylistic changes over time, what the person you're speaking to did with the artwork. For example, she was a collector, what did she do with it and how did she acquire it? And it's a very fruitful technique also for the emergence of new research questions, because they say things you don't always expect that you realize are important and you should investigate. One, just a tip here, if you ever do it yourselves, as with photo elicitation, which I'll discuss next, describe the image for the audio recording so that when you go back, you know what the transcript is referring to. So here's one. I want to give you an example how I didn't do it very well so you can learn from my mistakes. So this was a conversation that I had with the lady in a woman in France who had was a human rights activist in Paris, and she had received and sold thousands of these ephemeras during the early years of the regime. And Geneviève said, and we're talking about this picture. So this is, I have to describe the picture so you can understand more about the pitfalls of what I'm about to say. This is a factory. This is a standard icon for a factory, the jagged roof. And this is a bar with a man who's on the ground. This is a child with an empty plate, a man who you can see is, looks as if he's in despair. And it turns out, although I didn't know this at the time, that's a prostitute. So here's what she said. She said, "That's the man, the prisoner, who must be in that building. Remember that big building? The prisoner who must be in that building. And that's his wife who's prostituting herself." Now remember, I was doing this while I was photographing. Mistake. So this is, so it's maybe a man who's unemployed, who's depressed at home. And she said, "That's a child who doesn't have enough to eat. And that's the ex-worker who's drowning his sorrows in alcohol." And I say, "The child's begging for food." And she says, the daughter ends up as a prostitute. So problems here is an issue that you face with art elicitation. You have a choice between having a conversation while you're looking through the collector's artworks, as I was doing, and while I was photographing, or photographing first, then questioning. And I don't recommend doing what I did. I was interjecting, I didn't probe, I couldn't ask her enough, because I was focused on getting the images done. And also, we just had a long, semi-structured interview with this woman and her husband, who was rather ill, and she really wanted it to end. So much better is, and it was a long interview, much better it would have been to ask to come back another day, to photograph while not talking, and then do the talking if they wanted me to stay or to come back just for that very last part of it. When you're doing art elicitation, one issue is your time can be limited if you're getting through a big pile, as we were, of over 30 artworks. And during analysis, you can see that there might be misinterpretation of part of the artwork's message by the person you're asking. For example, she thought this was a prison, and it's understandable, that image. But from ephemera iconography and having seen hundreds of ephemeras, it's very likely a factory. And of course, the research subject doesn't have all the information. The person you're speaking to doesn't have all the answers of the information that's lacking. So this moves us on to a related technique, which is a rather well-known technique, which you're probably familiar with, called photo elicitation. Now, photo elicitation is basically asking people about photographs. Now, the way I did this is really sort of borderline art elicitation, but I'll tell you anyway, just so you get an idea of the concrete experience. I had photograph collections of the artworks, and some of them I didn't understand. So I took a whole pile of photos of a collection that belonged to a woman who'd worked in the eastern part of Santiago, and I took it to a group that had contributed the artworks to this collection many years before, and I asked a woman in the group to explain them to me, because some of them were not clear to me. And I did the same in the northern part of Santiago. And that's just one example. I also used it, as I described, in a way similar to what I described before, for stylistic purposes. Now, photo elicitation can be done with all kinds of images. You can have photographs of protesters, and you can approach a dissident and say, could you please tell me what's going on here? And if it's their own group, their own dissident group, you can ask them to talk about how is it that they came to do this protest? Why in this place? Why at this time? What were they trying to communicate? And very fruitful, I found, is to show a photograph of another group. So show a contrasting photo on the same theme. So you have group B, and you can ask your informants, how are your protests different from this one, for example? How are your experiences different? And the contrast turned out to be a technique that was extremely fruitful. Photo elicitation can also be very helpful when talking about a difficult period for someone. So, for example, writing about the experience of having a relative disappear. This is something that's very hard for interviewees to talk about, very painful experience. So one could start, for example, with a photograph of a protest by relatives of the disappeared and move on from that, because if you're talking about a third object, it's out there, it's something that they are involved in, and then you can move in later on in the interview to asking about their experience. And it can be very fruitful for that. So here is an example of one of the artworks that I had a photograph of, and I took to a woman in the eastern part of Santiago. This is what I didn't understand. What was this? And she explained to me, these are tires that we light up, so tires that we set alight, and we use them to make a barrage, block the street, so that vehicles, military vehicles of others, can't pass by. And here, by the way, is, I mentioned earlier how they can give an indication of the women's understanding of the situation. Here you have a factory that's closed, so unemployment, possibly, I'm extrapolating here, but why? Because there are many imported products. Tariffs had been dropped, imported products were flooding the market. That could be her interpretation. Right, so moving on to photographing groups at work. This is something I did a little bit for various reasons, but I'll tell you how I did it. I wrote a chapter of my book, Art Against Dictatorship, on how the artworks were actually made. How were they made? The process of making them. So I took photographs in workshops where they were being made of the women working on them and of the pieces of artwork themselves as they were in process. And I also, another way I did photographing groups at work was photographing protests in the street. So relatives of the disappeared were still protesting, asking for an end to impunity, and I went into the crowd and photographed their protests, and I went behind the scenes, behind the line of behind, you'll see in a minute, and so that's a way you can photograph dissident movements at work, for example. Now, there are many issues with this. The reason I didn't take many photographs of groups at work was that I felt very uncomfortable about stepping out of a role that I'd achieved of a participant more than observer, of quasi-group member over an extended period of ethnographic research, of fieldwork in these ephemera groups, and then being the outsider again, or the person taking the photographs, made me very uncomfortable. Also, the power issues involved. So I took very few. I wish I'd taken more, but there you go. Also, it was, and I was very aware that photographs in a small, closed setting do influence research subjects' behavior. So you're in a small room where people are making something, but the fact that you're photographing made some of the women display the ephemeras on the table a bit for me in a way that they wouldn't naturally do if they were just working on them, of course. But to my surprise, they were actually very, in the cases I gave back photos, which I did, they were very grateful for the photos. So there was an aspect of reciprocity, giving back to the research subject, which surprised me as being something positive about having taken the photos. This is the relatives of the disappeared, and this photo shows us one of the visual symbols they use to reflect disappearance. This says, I'm a victim of the dictatorship, did you remember me? And you can see them protesting here. And you can see just a few carabinet policemen But then getting behind, this is right behind that image, this is the silhouette that you saw that they were carrying. You can see there are many more policemen. You see they're in front of Chile's equivalent to the White House. And you can see that you can't see it too much, but from having triangulating with field notes, it was a rather relaxed atmosphere, despite the large number of policemen. People were talking to each other. There wasn't that as much tension as one would expect, as I recall. These are the ones where a group was at work, a group reduced to three. This is where they're laid out on the table a bit for me. You can see that the children are present while they work. You can see the threads hanging up there. And here, this was a very useful photo when I was writing a chapter on how one makes an ephemera. Because in interview data, I read that she had, first you do this part, then you sew it onto this part, then you do the mountains, then you do the trees, and it's all very clear right there. Okay, so now I return back to, I was here, came back from the field, came here, and I was writing the book Surviving Dictatorship, and what I really felt I needed was pictures of women during the dictatorship, and of their environment, of the shanty towns, of their homes, of their experiences with poverty, and their collective efforts to overcome these problems. So I had this challenge of looking for photos of shanty towns and finding photos of shanty towns from abroad. Now you can imagine, with exacerbated poverty because of the extreme neoliberal economic policies that Pinochet instituted, there weren't that many cameras in the shanty towns. And I was away from the shanty towns anyway, so how did I find these photographs? Well, I found them in bulletins by leftist, by dissident political groups, clandestine political groups produced news bulletins. I found them there through WorldCat and Melville, using WorldCat and Melville, the library research tools. Bulletins by associations of relatives of people who disappeared, people who'd been executed, people who'd been who were political prisoners. Some of these I picked up in Chile before leaving from their connections. Exiles newsletters. So exiles, refugees, can be very active, producing documentation, newsletters. They have photos there. Church publications, because the church supported the women's collective efforts to raise an income. So there were church publications, academic publications. Shantytown-based collective memory groups had them. And one or two shantytown memoirs by shantytown inhabitants. This is where I found the photographs. Some loose photographs I copied in archives before leaving Chile. So here is what some of these photos tell you. Now the problem with these photographs was they were mostly taken by photographers or academics and not members of the shantytown. This is a problem. Nevertheless, they were helpful in helping me understand and deepen my knowledge in other kinds of data that I had. So for example, I had participant observation field notes where I had mentioned walking with a woman from a shanty town down the street. She said, it's very important for us to have a big, good fences because we're afraid of burglars. So this photograph, I believe, helped me to understand perhaps why this fence is quite so high and significant in a home on the edge of shantytowns. They were afraid of burglary. It also tells us about the urban environment there, the streets not being paved, for example. This is a picture of showing us a room, a bedroom of these two boys. The roof, the bigger picture shows a couple of buckets. The roof leaks, so they've got this corrugated iron, so it doesn't leak on the blanket, but it drips off. And he's warming his hands on the flame. And this is an issue of overcrowding that's suggested. She's putting up a washing in a small space between buildings. Here we have an idea about a common form of housing. This is again probably a memoirs. Looks like one. The ground is not paved, it's muddy, there's a stream here, there's barbed wire. And there are many issues with this, as I'll tell you in a minute. Here you have, the shantytown environment in winter, the wet, open pipes, etc. Here's an issue. You sometimes find a picture bang across the pages of a book. So that's problematic if you want to publish it yourself. This is a public latrine in a shantytown. This is how I solved this problem. In my book, I sort of made it two images. I don't think I did it altogether successfully, but that was an attempt to get rid of the book, where the book pages join together. Here you have, here you have people lining up for water because they didn't have water in their own homes. So they're lining up and taking heavy containers back. And here we have children in scavenging for food, foraging for food, or looking for food in a garbage dump. And this is a very common practice of hooking up to public electricity lines because they couldn't afford to pay the bills. So I was told in interview data, and so very often there was a dangerous practice of getting electricity from public lines in this way after one's electricity had been shut down. And these are the lines for healthcare in the local shantytown clinic. This is a long line, and interview data told me they would line up from about 3 a.m. and sometimes the doctor, they would come to the front and they would be told, the doctor can't see you, they're going now. This is moving on to collective efforts to deal with extreme poverty. So this is a knitting group where the work they did was bought by the vicaria and exported to give money to the women. And here we have a comedor popular or comedor infantil, where women through begging or donations were able to make meals for lots of their children and feed them in a chapel of the Catholic of one local chapel. This image shows you that, and it also shows who collaborated to help. So here, I knew from interview data that local shantytown priests were often extremely forthcoming, lending their rooms for this kind of economic coping strategy. And so it tells you about who is helping, who's collaborating to help these women. And I just want to show you for reference in a minute, the children with their spoons outside, that's going to come up in a slide in a second, this one. So here's an ephemera. So remember I talked about double cross-checking with other sources of data. So here's an ephemera where we see the children with their spoons. We see a latrine, public latrine. Through interview data, I learned that these are flies, these little things. And here are women lining up for water with the buckets. And this is a woman, and here too, saying, look for work, to her husband who's unemployed. So this really gave me, by combining and comparing different sorts of data, it gave me confidence that I was understanding these pictures in a way that was more close to probably what the artist intended than otherwise. And therefore it gave me confidence to use them in my analysis. This is a soup kitchen for everyone in the community. They're called ollas comunes, for adults and children. They're making the food, as you can see, huge pile of beans there, and they're distributing it in the backyard of a church. And here you can see people eating the food outside, standing up. And this was considered a slightly dissident activity because effectively it was saying, we can't feed ourselves. So it was a comment on the government's inability to have people feed themselves. And moving on to state violence, these photographs showed, I had some very fortunately, of the inside of the National Stadium. Now the National Stadium in the days and weeks after the coup was somewhere where people were sometimes rounded up in factories or taken from workplaces, and they ended up here. And the average the experience of the women I spoke to, this wasn't the common experience, that you had a relative disappear long term. But it wasn't that uncommon to have a husband disappear for a few days or a few weeks, and this is where they would end up. So you can see men here waiting around and the intimidating environment. And I, an issue I'll discuss at the end, so I contacted this author, the first photographer here, and I asked, you know, how did he take this photograph? And he didn't tell me. But I think he was perhaps a soldier at the time. Through interview data, I knew that the soldiers sometimes appeared in shantytowns with painted faces, and this terrorized children who couldn't see who it was. And this alerted me to the relevance of this photograph, because it shows just that. And this was a surprise to me, the fact that people are milling around, appearing not too tense, they're right up by the military vehicle, and I guess it's probably been there for some time. Again, we have this issue here with how do you scan something when it's over two pages of the book. And coming to the end of the photograph section, this is probably, again, so you're dealing with one of the issues is often they don't have captions, or they have captions that don't fully explain the picture. This is an example. But my guess is, we know that there were shantytown raids where soldiers would come into a shantytown, take away the men for questioning and take them to a large open space for several hours in the middle of the night until dawn, and the women and children would be left in the home. And perhaps this is at that early morning stage when they should be free soon and the women and children there. Not sure, there was no caption, but that's likely. Here's an example of protest. Men and women were involved in a protest, which was a funeral march. There was the occasion of a protest of a French priest, a much loved French priest in the shantytown, when a stray bullet from a soldier who was raiding the shantytown with other soldiers hit him in the head. And he was in his bedroom and it went straight through the wall. And here's a protest for housing. You can see they want house soon. People had this desperate need for housing. They're often living with relatives, living in the back room, in the patio of basically a wooden shantytown house, and they desperately wanted housing. You can see women and children involved in this one. And here's a protest by relatives of the disappeared, so long-term victims of enforced disappearance, and they would chain themselves to fences and wait till the police freed them, so they'd be there a good chunk of time. And here you see them with another common form of protest, even more common, was to march with photographs saying, where are they? Photographs of the disappeared person. And the woman in the middle was one of the groups that I was working with. They also used to put up posters like this or photographs with ¿Dónde están? Where are they? And they would be ripped down by the police in the early morning. And last one, this is a photograph of a poster, which although it's not that visual, I just want to use it as an example of how these photographs of textual or visual icons can show us who cooperated with whom. So this is about come to a video showing by one of our inhabitants who was killed in this shantytown, La Victoria. And it's put on by the Association of Relatives of Political Prisoners and of Artists of La Victoria. So we can see from this large amount I've just shown you of photographs that they can inform us about collective coping strategies, about protests, about other forms of resistance like making posters, about the shantytown environment, and about collaborations, who's helping who. They can help develop fuller understanding of material by comparing with other forms of data. However, there's often no information about the location, which group is depicted, the date, who's doing the photographing, and in many cases it was not women in shantytowns. And when you have a specific research question, a specific population you're trying to study, you need to go through a huge amount of publications to find images on this group. Because I was going through, remember, refugee publications, dissident group publications, but we're interested in many other issues related to human rights, and not just shantytown women. So I would order on through WorldCat and the fantastic interlibrary loan service we have, I would order stacks of publications, and I received stacks, every other day. There'd be stuff coming in, and they lent me a desk so I could just wade through without taking them all off to the office and look for pictures of shantytown environments and also of women in shantytowns. So that's photographs by others. I also wanted images by the women in the shantytowns themselves, other than Adpiras. And a way you can find such images when you're doing research on situations of state violence or exacerbated poverty is there are things called ephemera. Ephemera is a word used to describe posters, handbills, basically disposable documents. In this case, I found a collection, a very good collection, from Princeton University Libraries of small flyers this size encouraging people to protest by people in shanty towns, and I focused on those by women, of which there weren't that many, but small flyers that were written and often had a picture saying, come to the protest 23rd of April at 5 p.m. in such and such a place. And they would be dropped on the street, and the women would drop them on the street and quickly move on, as they told me in interviews. Or they would sometimes nail them to a tree and very quickly, again, move on. So there were handbills. There were handbills aimed at soldiers, where the women had written, soldiers, don't attack your own people. Don't attack your tu pueblo. And flyers advertising apparently innocuous cultural and educational events that were actually events to radicalize people and make them aware of the extent of poverty and violence and the fact that they were experiencing human rights violations. And also I found handwritten and photocopied newsletters. So some groups made newsletters by hand and some typing, and they photocopied them and distributed them just among their groups. And also booklets. Relatives of the disappeared, for example, had made booklets about their experience. So all this is called ephemera. You can find them in items like this in archives, in rare books collections, in shantytown libraries, in collective memory organizations that were set up at the end of the period of conflict. So here are some. We see this one I particularly like because it also shows humor as a strategy for resistance, not only in the visual image of these rather simpatica pregnant ladies who are saying, let's defend the family, and they're asking for better health care for women who are giving birth, who will give birth. And you also see humor in the text. This is a slang word for Pinochet, chinchon. They used nicknames, sorry, not a slang word, a nickname. So that shows, what does this one show? It shows one of their concerns, and it shows the kind of activities they were engaged in, creating such documents to raise awareness, radicalizing. Here's another one that suggests something quite innocuous, right? The first woman's song festival. But the visual image suggests, you know, she's not going to be singing lullabies. Mm-hmm. You know, she's, this guitar looks almost more like a rather large implement. And this kind of event was used to introduce ideas about the extent of poverty, violence, and the fact that they were experiencing human rights violations by this group, some of whose members I interviewed. Here's one that, among other kinds of data, brought out one of the findings that shantytown women sometimes first become involved in protest under dictatorship, so dangerous conditions, because they protest to give solidarity, to express solidarity for other groups. So this is a flyer about a solidarity marathon, an event where there'll be song, dance, music, poetry and theater to raise money, where you go along and you pay a small amount, and the money goes to people, local people, who need the money to travel to visit their relative in prison, or a group that needs money to afford the materials to make the arpilleras, for example, or the food for a soup kitchen. So this and other data show me the importance of solidarity and giving, showing and expressing and raising concern for and raising funds for other people, for these groups of women. Now here we have a flyer saying, participate in the national strike, and it tells you how to do that. And the image is an image of a very homely, approachable sort of woman. And this is something that I think helped make it more conceivable that every woman, every man, or every woman could be involved in. Here is the cover of a photocopied and often handwritten bulletin by a group of women in shanty towns. And that's the front page. These things would be about 8-9 pages long. And just on the front page, you can see women protesting under words all together for the 25th of March for a protest that they were obviously going to participate in. And this one shows you, invites people to pay homage in a day-long workshop to pay homage to groups who've been falsely accused by the government of where individuals have died because groups were fighting each other. Whereas in fact, it's to pay homage to freedom fighters, members of the human rights movement, and people fighting for life. And this one tells us that, you know, this is they're accused by the government of having died. These people who were paying homage to died in conflict between groups, but in fact, state violence is the ultimate cause. And you see here, it's by the Committee of Human Rights of a shantytown called La Legua, and by Association of Relatives of People Who'd Been Executed. And I believe this is the last one. This is a summer school flyer. Now, summer school sounds innocuous, right? But shantytown women's groups like the Frente and the Queres from the south of Santiago organized day-long and sometimes week-long talks and workshops where women would discuss their experience and encourage them to reflect on why they're suffering from exacerbated poverty, why are their husbands employed. Essentially, they were radicalizing events. And this image shows, you know, women who are speaking out and who are protesting. And this reflects one of the challenges that the organizers faced of getting women, as they've used this term, getting women out of the home. Many women were in the home. Which, of course, shows you all of these suggest one of the shortcomings of ephemera. They don't represent your average shantytown inhabitant, because these are the organized people who are making these documents. So in this case, we're looking at the ideas and the concerns and the documents of radicalized, already highly radicalized shantytown inhabitants. It's very hard to find ephemera, because many ephemera they're made to be thrown away, or they're not made to be kept. Luckily, at Princeton University, the librarian paid someone in a shantytown to collect ephemera in this part of Santiago. So it depends on the subject matter. But as I'm aware of, there's two collections of ephemera. There might be more, but there aren't that many. And there are very few. In my case, I was looking for things by women in shantytowns. There aren't that many of those. So there's an issue with finding enough. Again, we know little about date, authorship, and location. It helps to know the initials of the group that made them. They sometimes describe themselves with initials, so if you're familiar with the groups in that area, that can help. Otherwise, it can be difficult. Sometimes I didn't know if it was something by men and women or by a group of women. Lots of unknowns. Not that many clearly by women of the shantytowns. So we've discussed today, and I'll talk about publication issues for 1 minute after this, but we've discussed photographing artworks by survivors, art elicitation very briefly, of course, photo elicitation, photographing groups at work, collecting published photographs, and collecting ephemera. Now, when it comes to publishing visual data, there are many challenges. One is that the editor of the journal or the editor of the book often has limited funds for visual images, so you're told to reduce. Now, I was very lucky with Routledge. They said, first, it's good to tell them from the start when you present the project, this is going to be something that needs a lot of images, but they offer to put a whole lot on the book's website. So the sort of second choice ones that I couldn't include in the book, I was able to put on the website, which was a very good solution from my perspective. I was very happy about that. There are ethical issues with including photographs by others. You have to have permission. Now, how do you have permission when you can't find the photographer, or the photographer has passed on, as was the case for one of these? So you have to produce a record of your efforts for the publisher to find the photographer, and show, if ever there was a legal issue, you can show, well, I contacted the magazine he worked for, no longer exists, I contacted the next place, etc., etc. Then there's very, very tedious work of saying at the back, you know, where you have a long section of figures at the back saying exactly what publication they came from, that in addition to your massive bibliography. So those are just some of the issues. I guess the basic takeaway is, I think that collections of visual data sets are best analyzed and can be used with most confidence by researchers who want to do rigorous research when you can also draw on other forms of data to cross-check the information, to make sure you fully understand what's being represented, and be they other visual forms of data or textual forms of data. And many times I was hesitant to use images as much as I would have otherwise, because I didn't. There were a lot of unknowns. When exactly was it done? What neighborhood? Who took that image? So thank you very much indeed for your attention. We've gone through a lot of material. Thank you.
Thank you, Jacqueline. And now it's my job to take the cue. Any questions? Yes.
So I have another sort of pragmatic question. The photographs of what we've been working, I'm wondering how you handled that vis-a-vis IRB and sort of human subjects protections for the people that you were interviewing?
This is early on when I was doing, this was very early days research for the dissertation. I was at the University of Essex, and I had to go through their IRB system, and I mentioned that I was going to be using visual documents. And I'm afraid more detail than that I can't tell you. But what you can do is that you can say clearly who you're going to photograph, that you ask their permission, that informed consent will be involved. And if there's no, you present the risks to them and describe the situation, and depending on what you're doing, it should be okay.
Yes.
Thank you. That was fascinating. The visual methods are all fascinating, half a dozen or so. Can you say a bit more about how you triangulated those results with your interviews and some of the other work that you were doing?
Sure, yes. So very often, I didn't feel I could rely just on visual images to analyze for the particular question I was seeking to address, for example, in an article or a chapter, because I didn't know enough. So I had coded, as in grounded theory, I had coded the data from the interviews and the field notes, and also the art elicitation interviews and the photo elicitation interviews. I coded them, and I was able to find the relevant part of the relevant interview and make sure that I was, it helped me understand the visual images better. And it also worked the other way around. So when I was writing Surviving Dictatorship, I started off basing it on interview data. Really, it was based on visual and interview data. But I went through image by image of my photographic data set, I remember at one point, asking myself while I was doing it, what in here adds to what I've written about X theme? How does it contradict? Is there anything I need to alter? So there was a continuous sort of, at that stage, altering or adding to. And then also, with that part of the work, I used a lot of the, when I was going through one by one these photographic images, I was writing paragraphs about them as captions right away at that stage. And a lot of them, the captions in my book sometimes are rather long, they're paragraphs, because I wanted it to be a book not just about based on the word, but also based on the visual image. So the captions are very important. And I got that, as you know, some anthropologists, Margaret Mead and Gregory Bateson, have used very extensive captions. So I took that idea from them and applied it there.
I'll ask a question. How is it that you deal with the Goffman problem, which says, how do I know if it's how do I know if the person is winking or it's a twitch, which is in some particular way is involved in these pictures? Because some of the art pieces that you're taking, the real question really becomes: is this the way it is? Or is this the way it? I mean, in other words, when you take it and say this is the way it was, that is as a picture in some of the art pieces, or is this the way they think it is?
Yeah.
And I don't know that that's a different question than yeah. Well, it's a different question, yeah. Than some of them that you've raised actually.
Look, absolutely. I mean, pictures are constructed images. You know, the ideas were constructed by the women who were making them, who were making choices about what to include, how to do it, what to put in the frame of the picture, and then doubly so because there was an intermediary there. And I take these as representations of what people wanted to depict, both the artist and the intermediary, who had an understanding of what buyers wanted. And I did not have the confidence, because of this very issue, to use them. I didn't feel it was rigorous to use them on their own for any piece of writing. I always also referred to the, for example, remember the photograph of the latrine and the soup kitchen and the children with the spoons? This sort of comparing, cross-checking, gave me more confidence that this was what was actually going on. Perhaps not all together in one frame, but in a shantytown, and the same with interview data, and the same with field note data. So it was for me, it was very tricky, and that's why I always felt that I didn't have enough information about, I couldn't always interview the artist. Another way was photo elicitation helped a lot, and it could help even more if you can do more photo elicitation with the person taking or making the image, because then you can actually ask them, and that helps solve the problem.
Christine.
Yeah, so I see how your strategy of triangulation assists you in understanding better what the artist was intending to depict, but I'm wondering about the intention behind the depiction. In other words, how do you get at if the artist is depicting X scene because that's what the buyer wants to see, versus this is an act of political resistance that the artist is engaged in. And if it is the latter, I'm really interested in how creating these art pieces was a kind of safe form of political expression and resistance, if you found any evidence of that, or was it risky? Were these women risking something by depicting the political message that they were in these pieces?
So you know, you're absolutely right. Is it this question occurred to me frequently, but we know from interview data that the women were rather angry about being told what to depict. In that, even this instruction, you have to depict your lived experience. Some of them wanted to depict the way they wanted things to be. And there were various ways. I had an interview where a woman described how she, the vicaria said, okay, we don't want to show glue sniffing. Take the glue sniffing children out of the picture. So she went home, made the corrections, and put the children back in behind the bush. So there were various strategies of resistance that they described, where they resisted the efforts of the vicaria. And you know, how do I know? Also, just from what you ask is also interesting, because in the early days of the regime, there was a real emphasis on denouncing and on showing what was happening. Whereas in the later days, by the late 80s, there the women were succumbing much more, because there was more pressure on the vicaria to sell. People were turning their attention in Europe and elsewhere to other crisis situations. They weren't buying as many ephemeras. The vicaria was putting the pressure on the women more, being more directive and telling them to do less scenes of violence, because as one vicaria interviewee told me, no one wants to put scenes of violence in their living room, she said. So over time this changed, but from doing very many interviews, both with vicaria staff and with women, I think I can say with confidence that yes, the women were always directed, but yes, they were more depicting more their own experience in the early years of the regime than later. And your question about the risk, they were very frightened to do this. Mm-hmm. And one organizer actually said to me that she would persuade women to join the group by saying, oh, well, we'll just be doing, this is work where you can earn an income. And she said, we'll be doing pictures. We'll be doing some pictures. She made it sound innocuous. And once the women were in the group, it was easier for them to stay in than to get them in, because people were afraid of joining any group for fear of being thought of as a leftist, which could mean have very serious consequences. So you can see the feeling of fear in the fact that some of these, like that one I showed you with the four men representing the junta, are disguised. And there's all this code language going on, which I had to try and learn. So there was constantly a sense of risk all the way through. And even at the even after the regime, they were still somewhat wary of me, the outsider, and asking to participate in the groups. 5 years after when I first began this. Yes, very much so.
Yes.
I really appreciate your honesty about the mistakes that you felt that you made.
Lots more.
But I was struck when you were talking about interviewing a woman in Paris while trying to photograph at the same time, and that you later realized she had misinterpreted the picture because she thought it was a prison, whereas actually you identified it was a factory. And I just wonder how you handle kind of both the, you know, what that tells you about what, you know, what she is and how, you know, she's a human rights activist but exiled. She's constructing the picture in a way as well in her interpretation of it, correct or incorrect.
Yeah.
And then also how you maybe handle that situation in the moment.
Well,
you know, do you keep quiet about the fact that, well,
I didn't handle it well. I mean, I said, if you remember that line, perhaps he's a man who's unemployed, who's depressed in the home. That's how I responded. But really, I should have kept quiet because I'm not meant to be interjecting. But at the same time, I was there with the camera and I felt this pressure. They want me out of here. I really should have come back. But, okay, so she was a human rights activist who was French, and she worked to help refugees who came from Chile and other countries. But she really felt emotionally about the Chilean experience under Pinochet. So she sold thousands with her husbands of arpilleras, and she even took photographs of them, turned them into books and postcards, and sold those. She was a real impetus of this funding effort, and very early on. So so your question was, how do I react in the moment? And her interpretation, well, so, you know, there's no one truth, right? There are different interpretations of pictures. We have to allow that. How do you deal with the fact, though, that familiar with the iconography of the arpillera, whenever you see a jagged roof and closed doors, usually indicated by an X, remember that later arpillera with the red X? That nearly always, from other interviews I know, and I didn't know what this meant before I did the interviews, signifies unemployment. Now, that building was a massive building with doors that were physically closed. There was no X. It was unusual. But I think I can say with confidence that that was a factory. So, you know, so she was a collector. She had kept about 30 to 40 of these images that she had not sold because she particularly liked them.
Wouldn't one of the real problems would be, I mean, it depends on what your question is, right? I mean, it depends what the research question is.
Yes.
So if the research question is, how does art change over a particular kind on a subject matter, then you could kind of actually look at different forms of the expression at certain times. But then if you're talking about what are the subject matter by which it is it thinks is salient? That is, does the expression of these shantytowns, the people in these shantytowns, the women in these shantytowns, because essentially what you're arguing here is an aggregate question, I think. In other words, you're making a generalization about women in a shantytown, which is okay, but what we need to have a very large data set of art coming from that section, in which we find out what were the subject matters that were most being depicted in order to determine what were the main issues.
Right.
And then the second really becomes the counterfactual to that, or the one we worry about, would be whether the depiction, that is, even if we saw large numbers, let's assume that, for the sake of what I'm saying now, that you find that the issues were really not about political freedoms, but about feeding, just feeding children and themselves. And you see this depicted 100 times, we'll say. Well, then the issue for us is to separate out whether that occurs, because that is the issue with them.
Yeah.
That occurs because this is the expression, this is the topic in which all artists are sort of taking their own slant on. That is, it's an artistic sort of following, you know.
Jean.
Yeah. Or whether this is what sells.
Yeah.
In other words, because you're really, with these organizations, you're in the same place as the WPA during the 30s in the United States, which subsidized, actually, artists, to do their craft.
Right.
Yeah,
that's it. Yeah. Yeah, so, it is very difficult. Now, these, part of what gave me confidence that the women were truly trying to depict what they saw as salient aspects of their experience was the interviews with them. And the fact that themes, although I had 500, they came from many different sources. So I had ephemeras from this collection in France, in Switzerland, in England, in the United States, in Chile, from publications of ephemeras. I started to scan images and publications and put them in. So yes, it's still a small sample, but I think the fact of, you see this image, now, you see the image of, say, soup kitchens over and over again, does give me and plus the interview data, plus the participant observation field notes, plus the photographs of these soup kitchens made by, not these women, made by other people who've taken the photographs, gave me some confidence that this is, so in this case, for example, this is really the experiences that the women had. But yes, really, ideally, you need to do art elicitation. I'm a proponent of for full confidence, yes, to be able to do that.
Yes.
So I guess I'm kind of interested in the third component of what Pinochet is talking about, and sort of what the difference between the women's interests and what they, could choose to highlight and what the buyers want says about power differentials between the global north and the global south, and the nature of aid for human rights issues. So I'm wondering if if there's a chapter on that in your book, or
The women were very much they were dependent, first of all, on this exporting organization for the livelihood of themselves and their families. Remember, their husbands typically were unemployed. That's why they joined the groups. In a small number of cases, the husbands would disappear. Small minority. So they were absolutely in a position of dependence vis-a-vis this exporting organization for their career. There was a very strong power differential there, because not only by the fact of their dependence, but the vicariate actually checked their works and made sure they did conform to the women's lived experience. They would ask the group leaders and other things, stylistic things. Did they, various stylistic points that the vicariate was looking for. Were they well finished, for example, was one criteria. Bien terminadas. And the vicariate had its idea of what buyers wanted based on anecdotal data. Refugees saying, please send more of this. Refugees in Europe saying, please send more of this. But the women, remember, were very eager to communicate to the outside world what was happening. And when the claps were being put on their ability to show the extent of state violence, they resisted. And they were very angry, they told me, with the vicariate when the vicariate started in later years to say less, no blood, no soldiers, etc. So the fact that, so the differential was there. There was very little they could do. There were incidents of resistance to this powerful intermediary that they engaged in. But ultimately, they needed to sell the work. So towards the end of the regime, they were being asked to produce arpilleras showing, for example, environmental issues, because the vicaria had cottoned on to the fact that people were interested in that in Europe. So it was such an interesting artwork, because it is a case of a commercial product that's being sold, but at the same time, it's part of a solidarity network. Where, remember, some buyers in the earlier years especially really did want the Chilean exiles abroad really wanted scenes of what was happening in Chile. They wanted to know. And they described, I interviewed exiles, and they said to me, some of them, that these were like news items. This was news we got about Chile. We would see this as something that was happening. So there was also demand for this scene, but this dribbled out, diffused over time. So yes, in my book I do address that, and I think it wasn't a nefarious, let's use these women and pay them a very small amount for their arpilleras to keep the money. The vicaria gave most of the money to the women, but kept some for their own salaries in that unit, which involved about three people. But I really do believe, from having interviewed those three people and others who worked in that unit at different times, that they were not out to exploit the women. They really wanted the best. And they, in the early years, wanted to also tell the outside world what was going on. And it was what buyers wanted at that time, early on. The solidarity market. Remember, this is a market I call the solidarity market. And I call it a solidarity system. And the solidarity market wants pictures of what's happening. They don't want these commercial pictures. And so the earlier ones, I think, were more of closer to the women's experiences, definitely, than the later ones, because of that power differential, but because of the market demand wanting those kinds of images.
Yes.
And in one artwork where there were four men and one woman, and in the explanation it was like eliminated that the four men were from the junta, I was wondering if it's like common for certain little details as such to be like maybe like not so focused on or like eliminated from the explanation to make the what's happening in the images more like universal or more able to be received by a wider audience, considering that they were like being exported and shared to different regions around the world.
Yeah. I think yes. You know, the word details that were often excluded. And you connect, you know, someone's making a choice about what to include and what not to include in these arpilleras. And in symbolic images like this, there's even more leeway for, you know, this is an imagined picture, and it's saying this happened through a metaphor, essentially. And I think that, choices about details and excluding and including were made all the time, as you suggest, by these women. It was sometimes a stylistic matter. There was a limit to four themes per arpilleras this size, for example. Mm-hmm. One could include four themes, and sometimes in that case. But on the other hand, sometimes I'm surprised at the details that were in there. Like, remember the flies around the latrine,
yeah.
Which I didn't know were flies until I showed this to someone who explained that to me. Yes, as well. So yes, these are constructed images, as you say, and choices being made.
Any other questions? Yes.
I have one. You mentioned the importance of cross-checking the information across data sources, but I'm wondering if any contradictions arose as you were looking for that, or maybe if they led to any questions that still remain kind of unresolved.
I mean, yes, because I remember changing things. I wish I could tell you an example, but when I was going through photograph after photograph, right, I remember this isn't quite how I'd understood it, and making alterations in the draft of the book when I was doing, this is quite late on when I introduced the photographs, and new issues. New issues came up all the time, like with art elicitation or photo elicitation is great for new issues, where people, based on a photograph, start telling you about something that you hadn't paid attention to or realized was important, but clearly it is. That's the beauty of that method. It's very open-ended. If you don't tell them what to talk about in the photograph, you show them the image or the artwork, and that leads to... wish I could think of some example. Right now I can't, but I can tell you definitely I was making changes and it gave me ideas that I had to pursue. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? Laura has one last question. It is our last question because she may collapse.
You described how the artworks tend to change over time. The more recent ones were a bit different. Given that 1973 is a while ago now, and even the end of the regime a while ago now, what knowledge do you have of the age of the women who were making the artworks and how far they personally were removed from the events?
Well, so the women who are making the artworks, from you mean the big events like the coup, that sort of, I mean the stuff in the center of town?
I would think so, yes.
Okay, so the women were in their 20s and 30s, and they were nearly all mothers when they started making these artworks. So they were young mothers with small children. And when I was there, they were much older, and they were talking about the past. So yes, that was an issue with selective recall, as you know, as an oral historian. But they didn't go to the center of town much, so they didn't see much of the protests in the center of town. And if they experienced this image I showed at the very beginning of the White House equivalent, Palacio de la Moneda, being bombed, none of the ones I spoke to witnessed that, but they witnessed how that was done in the shantytown. So soldiers in the streets, tanks in some cases in the streets, violence in the streets, and that's what I was interested in. I was interested in this book in telling a story that hadn't been told much of what was the experience and the work. And the work in terms of survival work, but also undermining regime work, activism, of women in shanty towns. So I was really interested in what they were experiencing right there. And I was very surprised during field work to learn that the women actually very rarely went into the center, and they stayed mostly within their shanty town, or they went to the shanty town where they might have a daughter or a sister or a relative. Their freedom of movement was relatively restricted by husbands, by norms. They weren't expected to be out trotting around town, and by income. It's costly to pay for transport and other matters. By curfew, for example.
Well, this could go on. But we want to be very kind to our speaker and thank you very much for a wonderful presentation.